Castellucci, and I'm here at Occupy LA, and I'm going to read from my novel Rose Sees Red. Rose Sees Red is a book about a Soviet girl and an American girl in 1982 in New York City, and they end up at the biggest no nukes rally in American history, which happened in 1982. So I'm going to read a little bit of that. The march. The sound was like a roar in the air when we emerged from the underground. "What is that noise?" I asked. "It's the march," Callisto said. There were thousands of people, all walking in the same direction, streaming up the streets. They were everywhere. Their voices singing, talking, humming, praying, their hearts beating, their feet walking, all together made the air buzz. And amazingly, all of them had come together for one purpose, peace. I ask you, how could you feel helpless against the bigness of the world with that kind of gathering? I ask you, how could you not be swept away? You couldn't. We swept into the stream of people headed toward the park, and I was glad that our voices made that crowd that much louder. And I could almost hear the change in volume that our voices added. I was glad of it. I thought that it would just be old hippies, Caleb said, looking around. Me too, I told him. I am pleasantly surprised, he said. It was an ocean of every kind of person you could possibly imagine, everyone who made up New York City, everyone who made up the world, professionals, parents, children, punks, physicists, yuppies, artists, actors, firemen, dock workers, cabbies, teachers, everyone. It was a people watching paradise, and they all had signs. Professionals for a nuke-free world, parents for no nukes, no wars, teach tolerance, teach peace, teachers say no nukes, punks for peace, physicists for atoms, not bombs. Get active, not radioactive. Who is Ron? Arena asked, pointing to a sign that said, "This is not a movie, Ron." Our president, Maurice said, Ronald Reagan. He was a movie actor, I explained. Oh, I see. This is real life and not a movie. Ronald Reagan, she said, and then she laughed. A huge blue whale balloon went by, and it had a thought bubble over its head that said, "Save the humans." Ha! I said, pointing it out to everyone. It's probably true that if whales could talk, they would tell us to stop having nuclear bombs, Callisto said. We all nodded. Those whales would definitely have something to say about it, I said. Too bad it's not in my skit, Caleb said. Let's go or I'll be late. We pushed deeper into the thick of the crowd, and I felt as though I were a part of something bigger than myself. I looked around at the other people. Some walked at our pace, some moved faster, and some took their time, but they were all like us. We smiled at them, and they smiled at us, and embraced us as a part of them. We shook our heads in approval back at them, and as we did, they welcomed us. People even handed us signs to hold up. Loving arms, not nuclear arms. Freeze the arms race. It's a world emergency. The crowd thickened, and the closer we got to Central Park, we had our free arms linked together so that we didn't lose one another, and with our free hands, we held up the signs. There were more people there than I'd ever seen in one place, more people on the streets than what I'd seen at a Macy's Thanksgiving Day parade. There were people with bullhorns, there were people with banners that said, "No nukes now." As we walked toward the park, I noticed that there were many people just watching us marchers walk by. "How can they just stand there?" I said. "We're not a parade." "Calm down there, radical," Caleb said. "They have the right to watch. Maybe they won't join us this time, but maybe next time." "But we're walking for them. How can they not be moved by the message that we all want to live?" "I think some people don't feel for the whole world," Caleb said. "It's hard to feel for the whole world," Arena observed. "It's hard to feel for your friends and family sometimes," I said, "but that doesn't mean you shouldn't try to." Arena seemed a bit overwhelmed by everything that was going on. And some of the bystanders were not just watching us passively, they were yelling at us as we walked by. There were people protesting the peace march. There were people screaming that we were the dangerously naive ones. They yelled, "Peace is a Soviet weapon." They yelled, "The devil's headquarters is in Moscow." They yelled, "You cannot trust those who are evil. They have bullhorns." What they were yelling hurt us all, but Arena was the hardest hit. And I looked at Arena and I could see how upset she was. She was holding onto her sign as though it were going to hold her upright, and I could tell that she wanted to cry. And we all touched her nicely so that she knew we felt terrible and that we did not think she was evil at all. "But who is the devil?" she said. "Me? You? Them?" The people lined up thought anyone who didn't think like them was the devil, and that was surely evil, but they were scared like we were. Those people yelling at us for marching are just as angry and upset as we are about nuclear bombs, I said. They feel that we are against real peace and that we are messing up their safety in the world, Caleb said. "Isn't that weird?" Callisto said. that two groups of people can feel so much like the other side is dangerous and naively misguided? That's why we're at war, Maurice said.